Hey guys, Jack Spirico here with another survival podcast video on YouTube for you. And I got a bunch of stuff for you in today's video. I think you'll enjoy it. I want to do a shout out at first to someone that sent me something really cool. A little ahead of the game here, but it's almost like I can read my mind. I've been thinking more and more about what I can do perennially as I build out more of these aquatic systems and aquaponic systems. And of course, I have a big expansion planned in the area straight behind the phone. Obviously, you can't see because it's pointed at me right now. But that area is going to actually have quite a bit of area that won't even just be in tanks and stuff like this. Actually, ground that will be protected from the ducks. And I've been thinking in some of the dirt that I hill up around the big water tanks that are going to go in there, what are some perennials that I can grow in there and put a little drip irrigation in straight off of the system or something like that. And since I'm in there doing maintenance all the time, it'll be easy to upkeep. And one of the things I've been thinking about adding is tree collards. I like collard greens, but I like perennials, and tree collards in my climate are pretty much a perennial green. And they handle temperatures down 25 degrees easy, and if they're, you know, properly kind of looked after, can handle down into the high teens. That pretty much takes us through most winters that we'd have here in North Texas. They're easy to clone, and that means I could just clone a few every year as a safeguard and keep them in the house under lights until the next season if necessary. And I think we would do that just as a safeguard. And we're going to have a plant propagation system set up inside one of the garages with a 300 gallon minimum water tank in it. As the plane strafe me here again, come on guys, give me a break. Well, let's let that pass. They're not quite supersonic today, but they're moving. Anyway, so we're going to have a tank in there just so I can overwinter some of the water plants that don't make it through our winter. Here he comes again. It's his wingman. It's like they know. Anyway, we're going to have a water tank in there and some racks and some grow lights and an aquarium heater inside the water tank so that we can overwinter some of the plants that don't make it through our winter. That way they're easy to kind of repropagate back into our systems in the following summer. So we'll have a place for these guys to go if necessary. I don't think they will be necessary. So what do they look like? You know, if you look at that, it looks like either a young broccoli plant or a collard green or something like that. These grow, though. They get about 3 or 4 foot tall and they fall over. And then they root and they send up another shoot and they kind of walk like that. Or you can prop them up and they'll get about 6 foot tall and you can just pull leaves off them whenever you want and they grow back. This gentleman that sent me, his name is Luke, and he has a site called projecttreecollard.org. I'll have a link in the video notes so you can check this out. He has multiple varieties available: purple tree collards, green leaf tree collards, dino tree collards, which is like the dinosaur Lancinto kale, diabenton kale, or variegated perennial kale, and merit tree collard. And you can learn more about all those at his website. What did he send me? I'm guessing plain old green leaf tree collards, because he didn't tell me and he didn't label them. So, hey, you can't complain when somebody sends you three very cool plants like this for free. They come in little peat pots. I went ahead and potted them up. They're in here under the 60% shade cloth in the aviary. That'll give them a good time to build out their root system. So I figure out what I'm going to do with them this year. He says you can plant them in, you know, like a 20-gallon pot is a good container to grow them in. I may do that this year so that I can transplant them next year into the system that we're going to be designing this summer and fall, because I don't know that I'll want to put them out that late in the year. But we may put some out and reserve one that we can move around on a little truck dolly or something like that. So these are something you want to check out for your systems. I know what you're thinking. Jack, why the hell don't you got all this land? Why don't you just plant them somewhere? Well, they're going to need some irrigation, but they do survive very high temperatures. Like in his notes, he says, in Las Vegas with up to 115 degree summers. But they're going to need some irrigation. So I've got spotty irrigation at different places. Remember, these systems are designed for trees, not so much something like this. The bigger issue is the quackers, though, man. They're going to eat this stuff. So if nothing else, I need to put them in into some sort of a pot and get them up to 5 or 6 foot staked, and then we can put them out, we can clone them, we can do lots of stuff like that. I think that'll be a good plant in our areas where we have irrigation installed and it's not spotty where I have to go out and do it. So we'll probably do that. But check out his website again, projecttreecollard.org. I'm going to pause the camera. We'll be using YouTube Editor today to splice all this stuff together because I got a lot to show you. The rest of it will be with me behind the camera instead of in front of it. In other words, your visual experience will probably improve. And it is windy and we got water running. I'm hoping the lapel mic that I'm using will help with this. I just want to give you kind of an update on these white Hubbard squash seeds that another listener sent me. and how they're doing. And as you can see, they're making a run for the border, man. I think the last video I did was about a week ago when I had that plant trained to about right there. At least when I had this plant on, it might have been 2 weeks, but it's, you know, it's gone a good 5 feet laterally, and it probably would have gone further. If you see the tip there, it's a little sad. It'll straighten itself up. It had rammed itself up in the corner, and I just got that redirected today. So if it hadn't been running into that dead end, it probably would be better. If you remember, I had a little watermelon here that failed. It just didn't get pollinated. Bees weren't doing their jobs. They were slacking. Well, look at here. That one is definitely set, and I think, you know, time will tell, because sometimes they get about that big and they shrivel up, but I think that's a good set too. So I think we got two baby watermelons. So I want you to start thinking about the possibilities here. And again, I am experimenting in here because I want to do more with this type of system without being contained in something like this little back wall. But in this little 100-gallon tank, right, we have multiple tomato plants. We got daikon radish that's getting just about big enough to yank out. Of course, daikon gets much bigger, but I wanted just a little harvest right here before I turn the front of it over to something else, just to do some fermented daikon radish, pickled daikon. And we got the beans, we got basil, we got two watermelon plants, we got Malabar spinach, we got sweet basil down here, and there's room in here. And because we're bringing everything to the plants, we can. Our limitation is more about light the nutrient. We have no nutrient deficiencies. If you look at the color of those tomato leaves, and tomatoes are considered a heavy feeder, there is not a nutrient deficiency to be had here right now. Coming down here, we've got a lot of room in this bed. This bed is being put into sweet potato production, and they're just starting to take off, and I'll show you how I'm rooting them in a much better way than in a glass jar here in a minute. Tomatoes are banging. We're starting to see tomatoes set everywhere. You can see I keep the understory pruned out really well, and I just throw all the prunings down there for the worms to eat. Tons of worms growing in this system now. Let me grab a sip of tea so I don't go hoarse here. And eggplant looking really nice. I just pruned a branch coming down off of this tomato vine that was really shading this guy out, so I think she'll take off a lot better now. The Asian eggplant, the Japanese Ichiban, they're looking pretty good too. I'm starting to see some fruit set on there, so kind of happy about that. The bees do get in here. I've been asked about that a bunch of times. They have no problem getting in here. They just aren't coming in here a lot. I am thinking, damn it. See, there's what I've been talking about. If I don't stay on this, that kink right there, if I wire that up, that'll probably heal itself. I'll get to that later, but that's like, you gotta stay on these vines, man. And on that note, if you remember, last week I did a video when the vine was here, and then 2 days later I did a video and the vine was here, and then this is about a week later and the vine's all the way down here. And what we've done now, we've run another wire coming like this, bisecting it to keep it off of this wall, get it down here. We're going to run that sucker like a chair rail. And the challenge with this, of course, is I'm trying to train the vine down, and where does it want to go? And by nature, it wants to go up. Once we get it on a horizontal path, though, it's a lot easier to maintain. We'll just have to stay on this and keep wiring the tip down every day. But we got good stuff going here again. Zucchinis are producing for us. That's the third one this year. The second one's inside. I'm going to probably make zoodles tonight. If I do make zoodles tonight, I'll do a video on how to do that. Yellow tomatoes continue to give me a couple for breakfast every day. Man, I love those things. And things are progressing well. Still have not built my next ebb and flow bed, but we'll get to that. Let's pause it. I want to take you outside and show you some other stuff going on, including some things that were like, damn it, I wish that didn't happen. Okay, first I want to start here. This is kind of the garden that I'm not really doing much with because it's going to go away. But I'm actually thinking about tearing out all these weeds and just throwing some buckwheat down here for the bees because that's a short, you know, 6 week crop. Because I'm thinking by midsummer, all this is going to start getting ripped out. I don't really want to put anything in here that I'm not going to, that I'm going to have to tear out, that I'm not ready to tear out, because that'll impede my progress. All those strawberry plants we can pull out and transplant. That'll be no problem. Comfrey, same thing. And we got some groundnuts in there that we'll be able to transplant. That, none of those are a problem. Any kind of vegetable or something, it just, you know, sucks to have it almost producing and then not producing. Anyway, if you see these little clumps right here, Those are those purple moussaka sweet potatoes. This bed grew sweet potatoes last year. I pulled a bunch out to share with people at the last workshop. But a few of them remained, and I'm actually getting much better slips by just pulling them out of there. So these are sweet potatoes that went perennial and overwintered and are coming back up on their own. That's something you can do in these southern climates that I don't think most people think about. And again, these two beds here are pretty much vacant right now. We'll probably put those into buckwheat this weekend just to give the bees more nectar. And what I'm thinking about doing is taking a couple trays in there and seeding them with buckwheat and just keeping them, you know, manually watered so they'll flower to give the bees more incentive to go in there and do more of their work in there. Or we could set up a little sugar bee feeder in there too. That might, you know, once one goes back and gives the wiggle dance in a location, everybody's gonna be zeroing in on there, but I have seen them there. On the bees, when I came out to do this video at first and got interrupted by the Lowe's delivery guy today, we'll talk about that in a minute too, there were bees everywhere on this pickerel rush. When I came back, there were only a couple. I wanted you to see them working it, but there's one girl there. And they might have worked it pretty heavy. And what they'll do is there's something with any kind of flowering plant called flow. Oh, there's a bunch in there now. And they'll work it while that flow is available. And when the flow stops, they'll go elsewhere. Now, with this being an aquatic plant, it has all the water it could ever need. It should have a lot of flow and a long duration flow. Mint. If you want something to grow in an aquatic system that's easy, mint. These are just pots set on cinder blocks so that they're, you know, about that much of the pot's in the water. And as you can see, mint don't care. It's a honey badger. Taro's starting to look better every day. These were pretty sad when I got them from the shop that sent them to me, but they're looking a lot better. The wild lamb's quarter is just growing here. It's about the last place I have lamb's quarter on the property. You know why? Because of those guys. You guys like lamb's quarters, don't you? So I'm letting this stuff go to seed. I'll cut off little shoots and all and use them in stir fries, but I'll let the main plant grow up so I can get another seed harvest out of these guys. Over here is where I'm propagating sweet potato slips. And I found that putting them in the ebb and flow beds, the root systems that you get are just massive compared, you know, to sticking them in a jar that's a conventional way. The bloody dock is looking really good, and I've been propagating this. Show you over here. I've got three more that are about ready to come out. I've got them down here in the sink, so they're protected. Freaking mice are eating anything good to eat off of my propagation table here. I keep trying to get these elderberry cuttings up, and I'll need to put these in where I put those collards to protect them from the mice long enough, but I've got some elderberry cuttings coming up in here, and the damn mice eat them off. So I have the bloody dock down in there. They just don't seem to want to go down there and tear it up on me, but we'll get that out into the water system soon. So I said something, you go, oh damn, I wish that wasn't necessary. Here it is. You might be wondering, what the heck is going on here? Well, this is the old supply line. It was 3/4, and it was running for about 3 years, throttled way back. If you remember, before we put the 2-inch lines in, we had to throttle it way back. And I think it just built up enough gunk that last week, my water coming into these beds just got weaker and weaker and weaker. And that pump's about 2.5 years old. I'd already ordered a new pump, and my plan was to pull the old pump out, stick it on the shelf as a spare, put the new pump in, 2 is 1, 1 is none. So I thought, okay, well, that didn't work out, but you got a new pump. So I threw the new pump in, and it did no good whatsoever. As an emergency, I put a T in, and I put both pumps in there to see if I could blow the line out, and I still had a piss trickle. Now down there, right off the two pumps, man, it was like a jet. It could have freaking run a boat. I'm telling you, you probably could have got up to 5, 7, 10 miles an hour running that as a boat jet motor. But right here, I had just a piss trickle, and it wouldn't even cause these things to function, the ebb and flow beds, and I couldn't actually get water coming out of all three at the same time. I'd actually just brought some fish into that system that were weak because of the failure of a bubbler, and but they had made it, but when this thing went and stopped going for a day, I lost a bunch of those new fish. The rest of the fish were adapted to the system, and they were strong, and they were able to survive, but we lost a good, like, 8 brand new fish out of this tank because of that. So, emergency procedure. What I did, and I had to run to the Home Depot to do this, because I had plenty of 1-inch material and plenty of 3/4-inch material, but no way to get them reduced down. And I just wanted to get this done fast, and the whole system was run on 3/4. So got myself a 3/4 to 1 inch reducer for both sides and just basically plumbed it over the ground. And I'll have my farmhand this week dig a trench. Fortunately, he doesn't watch my YouTube channel, so he doesn't know he's going to be digging a trench, or I'm sure he'd find out a way to be sick or something when he's supposed to come into work. But he'll have his young millennial ass digging that trench this week for me. And once we get that done, I'll plumb it all in with new. What I'm actually going to do is go that back piece that's all 3/4 back there, that's all going to come out. I need to get a bill of materials loaded up today so I know what to buy. I'm going to go to half inch with 1 inch to half inch reduction tees along the back side. That's what we've done in the aviary, and it gives you a lot greater control. For some reason, the 3/4 valves are very hard to dial in the speed of the tanks over there. And what I mean by that is you turn them up, they go from barely a trickle to just full on, and it's very hard to find that balance point where they'll trigger the ebb and flow bed, but they'll also be running slow enough that it'll break the siphon. So I've had some issues with that, and I've had no issues back there. So we're going to go to a half inch and 1 inch, which is pretty much standard on the whole property. There's some legacy 3/4 here, and I'm trying to get rid of it as much as possible. So that's another step in the right direction. By standardizing on everything, you know, you have two sizes, and that way you can have fittings for everything you'd ever need on hand at all times. And you're never looking at that one damn fitting and going, that's a 75 cent fitting, but I'm going to spend $5 in time and money to drive to the damn store to get it. And so that my stuff don't die, I need it now. Man, the wind, look at this. The wind has done it again. I've got to anchor this somehow, this Pickerel Rush. I probably shouldn't do this. You guys might get a funniest video or something here in a second as I try to step over and do this with one hand. But it just keeps pulling this off. There. No funniest video from Jack today yet. Falling into the system, but that Pickerel Rush, wired microphones. That Pickerel Rush just keeps getting blown out into that other part of that system. I need to put a wire around it or something just to prevent that from happening. You see, the bees are really, well, they're angry at me because I just moved their plant on them. But they're working this one a little harder. It's pretty overcast today, and that's probably why the bees are lackluster today. They're like union workers. They want to work when it's nice out. I know you're seeing a full swale, and you think, well, maybe we got some rain here. No, we intentionally flooded this today. That'll do a lot for irrigation for this tree system back here. Makes the ducks happy, and it saved me time. All I did was just turn the water hose on, set a timer for 2 hours, and walk away. You can see the rest of the property. We are very dry. We're forecasted to get some possibly severe weather and rain this week. I have my doubts that we're going to get either one. I don't want the severe weather, but damn it, I need the rain. You can see the difference where we've done just a little bit of irrigation. This has been irrigated twice this year in here. And you can see the difference between with the shade and irrigation versus what's out there. It's pretty dramatic. We really need the rain. I hope we get some. You guys that are fans of the show, you might be watching this late in the day, but there won't be a show today. There'll be a rewind on the podcast because I've got turkeys and bantam chickens coming tomorrow, and I'm getting everything set up and ready for them along with all these other things that need to be taken care of. Got one more segment for you before we wrap. All right, as some of you remember, I had planned on putting another water collection tank here, and this was filled with road base, which is now everywhere here, and we'll be doing some things to clean this up and make it look prettier in a bit. But as you can see, what we have now is the beginnings of a pretty nice tank. And those are just 4x4s, and they're pinned in with galvanized dip spikes. You can probably see right there. I don't know if you can or not, but they're in there. There's one right there. And a very stable structure. Well, what I'm going to do is I'm going to build it up about that high, give you an idea. So overall, it'll be about 4 feet, but on the outside, it'll be about 3 because this road base that we piled up out here, kind of built this up, so you can see there's a pretty big difference between that and that right there. So we'll be up about here. So, you know, on a person, you're talking about mid-chest height, and that'll hold, I think I calculated, at over 1,800 gallons of water. We're going to put a liner in it, an EDPM liner, and turn this into a pond, standalone. We're going to run power. We have power right there. We'll just pop power through right there. Just a single pump, just a fountain pump, maybe a waterfall pump. little bit of ebb and flow across the top just for filtration. It will not be tied into these other systems. This is going to be primarily a fish growing system, a very large fish growing system. And we're probably going to focus on growing bullhead cats because they're readily available. They're good to eat. They survive in just about any situation. And they don't take that long to grow out to a size that makes sense to eat them. So I mentioned the Lowe's guy. Let me show you what it takes to make this tank happen, and I'll show you something we're really excited about that has nothing to do with permaculture, just, well, maybe it does, because taking care of people is part of permaculture. See that box? We just had that box installed. It's a 220 power system for a friggin' hot tub. I'm putting a hot tub right there, and it'll be here probably next week. They're coming this probably Monday next week to put the pad in. It'll sit right here. We're going to be able to sit in our hot tub and enjoy this place, hydrotherapy. And again, we dilly-dallied on that one for a long time, and we weren't sure if we wanted to spend the money, and we eventually decided you can't take it with you. But in here, I had the Lowe's guy today calling me, called me twice from a number I don't recognize. I usually don't answer him. I didn't expect this to be delivered until tomorrow. But you see, basically, it's 4x4s and foam board. And this is inch and a half foam board. And we're going to put inch and a half foam board on the bottom and all the walls of that lumber so we have good insulation and good protection for our liner. And I'll tell you one thing about this Lowe's guy. He doesn't know how voicemail works, but this boy knew how to drive. I don't know if you've ever seen those trucks that the Lowe's guys drive. They are big, long, huge trucks. And this guy, I said, do you think you can get my front gate so I don't have to haul it from my far field? He said, no problem. He came through that gate, he pulled up there, backed up and came through. He never stopped, he never slowed down. He backed that thing in like he was backing a Yugo or a smart car through that gate. And I mean, he had about that much room on both sides and he had no problem doing it. And was able to get that stuff with that forklift to carry on the back of those straight into my garage. That'll save my farmhand some work. We'll have it out of the weather if it does rain. But I'm hoping this weekend to get on this project. And I'm going to order the liner today, and it should be a real easy one to knock out and get it up and running and cycling. Anyway, as I said, it keeps looking like rain, but it doesn't rain. We'll hope it does soon, and we hope things are going well for y'all. I'll catch up with you with another video soon. Remember, if you like our channel, you can check out our podcast. You'll be seeing stuff popping up here on the screen. Support us on Patreon. Check out our website. Subscribe to the podcast. Check out our other playlists. Whatever the heck I decided to put into this one, that's what's going on right here now.